When submitting a film for an MPAA rating, most distributors and directors are confident about the rating they want and hope the people classifying the movie will pick the most appropriate one. However, there's one rating nobody wants, and that's NC-17. The idea of this rating makes perfect sense. It's for movies that are absolutely not appropriate for young viewers. Unfortunately, the NC-17 and its predecessor X have caused constant headaches for a number of reasons, and the studios generally consider it the kiss of death. It wasn't always that way, though. When the rating system was introduced in 1968, the X was applied to a number of prestigious and successful movies. Midnight Cowboy was one of the earlier successes, even winning the Oscar for Best Picture, the only X-rated film to do so. By today's standards, the content in Midnight Cowboy isn't that shocking, and in fact it was downgraded to an R when it was re-released a few years later. Nonetheless, it showed the box office would not be affected by restricting minors. The second and only other X-rated movie to receive an Oscar nomination for Best Picture was Stanley Kubrick's A Clockwork Orange. This classification was certainly understandable, given the disturbing violence and sexual acts committed by Alex and his droogs over the course of the movie. Even 50 years after the movie's release, A Clockwork Orange remains a shocking piece of work. Nonetheless, it was a big hit when it opened in 1971, and became one of Warner Brothers' most successful movies at the time. There was also Ralph Bakshi's Fritz the Cat, the first animated film to receive the X rating. This was even highlighted on the poster, and was a major selling point of the movie. The popularity of Fritz the Cat not only launched Bakshi's feature directing career, but led to a string of other adult animated films during the 70s, although none came close to reaching Fritz's numbers. Over in Baltimore, John Waters was making a name for himself with his extremely low-budget films like Female Trouble and Pink Flamingos. The latter became especially infamous for its gross-out scenes, and Waters took glee in seeing how many viewers would rush out the theater in disgust. There was also Russ Meyer's Beyond the Valley of the Dolls, which is most famous for having a screenplay written by film critic Roger Ebert. Yes, Roger Ebert wrote an X-rated film, and even though many executives at 20th Century Fox looked down on the movie, Beyond the Valley of the Dolls became one of the most profitable releases. Certainly one of the most controversial X-rated films of the 70s was Bernardo Bertolucci's Last Tango in Paris. The film's depiction of sex, including Marlon Brando's use of butter in one scene, drew headlines, and the filmmakers were even taken to court in some countries on obscenity charges. The controversy wound up playing a huge role in the film's box office performance, as people went to go see it and find out what the fuss was about. Even pornographic films saw a rise in cinema attendance during the 70s, with Deep Throat achieving mainstream success and even inspiring the name of the famous Watergate informer. With the formation of the film rating system, filmmakers were allowed more freedom with what they were allowed to show on the big screen, and there was an excitement in the air. So what happened? Why did the X rating lose its prestige? Well, the fault on that lies on the MPAA. For some reason, they did not trademark the X rating like the other classifications, so porn producers and theater owners could just slap it on all their movies without MPAA approval, and this led to the stigma of X being associated with pornography. Most traditional cinema operators chose not to screen them, and newspapers and television stations refused advertising. This led to studios requiring directors to avoid the X rating. That's what happened with William Friedkin's controversial detective film Cruising, for example. The MPAA gave the film an X rating, primarily for the scenes set in gay bars. And per the orders of United Artists, Friedkin reportedly removed 40 minutes in order to secure an R. In the years since, Friedkin has tried to locate those scenes so he could create a director's cut, but has come up empty. This practice continued on as X-rated films were primarily relegated to arthouse cinemas. However, if you wanted to play wider, you had to edit your movie. This only heightened the perception that X was only for porn and exploitation. Examples of X-rated films that were seen as more artistic in their intent were Henry Portrait of a Serial Killer and Pedro Almodóvar's Tie Me Up, Tie Me Down. Critics also questioned the MPAA and asked why the content of those films were considered unacceptable, while the extreme violence of slasher movies like the Friday the 13th series could get away with an R rating. Finally, the MPAA decided to officially retire the X rating and replace it with a new rating, NC-17, aka No Children Under 17. So what changed? Absolutely nothing. When the rating was announced, most movie theater chains were quick to announce they would not screen NC-17 films, and print and television advertising also remained elusive. Blockbuster Video also said they would not stock NC-17 movies. Of the major studios, Universal Pictures elected to be the first to test the new rating with Henry in June. A movie based on the life of Henry Miller, it would forever earn its place in the history books as the first film released with an NC-17. It made $11 million at the North American box office, which is a decent number for a film that never entered wide release. Distributors otherwise chose to avoid the rating whenever possible. The big test came with Showgirls in 1995. This became the first NC-17 movie to open in wide release, and if it succeeded, it could legitimize the rating and prove it is not a detriment to the box office. MGM's confidence in Showgirls primarily was because of Paul Verhoeven. He had quite the impressive box office track record up to that point, with his three most recent films, RoboCop, Total Recall, and Basic Instinct, all becoming hits with audiences. Those three movies were all initially rated X or NC-17 by the MPAA, forcing Verhoeven to cut scenes out to secure an R. So he must have been immensely pleased when MGM informed him he would not have to edit Showgirls. He was even prepared for any potential blowback over the content, as he already experienced controversy over the explicit material in his Dutch film Spetters, but that did not stop it from performing extremely well in the Netherlands. Unfortunately, when Showgirls opened, critics tore it apart and it flopped at the box office. And with that, NC-17 became persona non grata, especially among the major studios. The conventional wisdom was that if a film was rated NC-17 and the director wanted enough people to see it, they had to go to the MPAA and make a case for why it should be rated R or find out what needed to be cut. Many directors find it an annoying process of back and forth and bargaining to try and get the rating down. Maybe one of the most notorious attempts to avoid an NC-17 was with Stanley Kubrick's final film, Eyes Wide Shut. It was given the rating for the orgy scene, which is one of the most important parts of the movie. Kubrick sadly passed away before the board screened the film, so Warner Brothers was hit with a dilemma. Cutting any scene from a Kubrick film would have been sacrilege, especially since the director always had final cut privileges with the studio, and he wasn't there to provide suggestions. So the decision was instead made to digitally insert shadowy figures in front of the offending moments. This led to outcry from cinephiles and critics, but the deed was done, and the unedited version of Eyes Wide Shut did not get an official release in North America until 2007. If a distributor does not want an NC-17, they can choose to release the film unrated. That happened with Requiem for a Dream, a film you would think the MPAA would want teenagers to see because of its message about the dangers of drugs. However, a brief sex scene in the climax was enough to get the higher rating. So Artisan threw up their hands and went, "Fine, we don't need your stinking rating." While the NC-17 remained undesirable in the 2000s, some distributors did start giving it a chance, including indie subsidiaries of major studios. Fox Searchlight decided not to appeal Bernardo Bertolucci's The Dreamers when it got the NC-17, and the film performed well in the theaters that played it. Sony Pictures Classics also released Pedro Almodóvar's Bad Education with the harsher rating. And when Ang Lee's Lust Caution received the rating, Focus Features similarly chose to keep it. Fox Searchlight even released a second NC-17 movie, Steve McQueen's Shame, starring Michael Fassbender. Miramax remained a holdout, though, mainly because the then-parent company, Disney, did not allow them to release NC-17 movies. And yet, ironically, following their purchase of 20th Century Fox, The Mouse now has a few NC-17 movies in their catalog. They're not on Disney Plus yet, but maybe someday. Over the past 10 years, the MPAA has actually been stamping less films with the NC-17 rating, especially compared to the 90s and 2000s. Some recent films that got it on the first try before chopping things out include The Wolf of Wall Street, Sausage Party, The Evil Dead Remake, and Midsommar. However, the versions we saw in theaters certainly were not lacking in extreme and shocking content. I was even surprised Midsommar was able to get away with an R in the end. Probably the most recent film to run into seemingly endless trouble with the MPAA was Spiral from the Book of Saw. The director, Darren Lynn Bousman, said he recut the film 11 times before they were satisfied and awarded him the R. Although pretty much every Saw movie has gotten an NC-17 on the first go, so it's almost like a badge of honor for the franchise. While the rating still remains a thorn in filmmakers and studios' sides, it does feel like movies are able to get away with more nowadays. The MPAA still objects to certain sexual acts, but some have started to creep into the R. Something like 50 Shades of Grey would probably have to fight to get an R in the 90s. However, when screened for the MPAA in 2015, it received an R with no edits required. There does remain a stigma with the NC-17, but with distribution models changing, Blockbuster Video no longer having any power, and people attaining the ability to rent or watch a movie on their digital device, NC-17 films are easier to find than ever. Want to see Blue is the Warmest Color? You can rent it off Amazon. The X and NC-17 have certainly had a rocky history, but as attitudes evolved, so what's considered acceptable for people to watch. See you next time.